Okay, then I'm Andrea. I will. this will be my the second part of the introduction to mathematical epidemiology, and I will start with a very quick introduction to R for those who have never used that. So, the idea is like many programs, you learn it by using. I'm not an expert, so I really don't want to give lectures on how to use it. I will give the idea of how to do something. And then, of course, you're welcome to look around at the help of how to do things. Look around on the web and see, I want to do that, and it's not working. And just to know, I have on, I think it's now on your website, on the desktop, you should have a file that was written for the students of a course. I just see it is. You should have it on your desktop. It's a file called Introduction to R, something like that. And it's something that was prepared by teaching assistant of mine for a course. Of course, there may be much better ones. But if you want to have some idea about R, I think that could be a starting point. Okay, so this, if you open, you can start writing on on your screen to the left, this first line here, this X, that I hope you do you all see?
What do this thing mean?
It simply means this symbol with the sort of arrow that is meant with to signify with is meant with less or equal and dash is an assignment. Actually, people can do it also with the equal sign, so it's actually would be exactly the same thing as writing X equal C of, I don't remember any longer what it was, but. Okay, I'll try. But you should have it on the screen so you can see it, but let's see how I can increase the font. You zoom in. Is it any better? So seems to be always the same size. However, once you write that, and you have to press on where there is written run, and this runs that line, so you have run, and this has made this vector X that has three components that in this case are 1, minus 1, and 3. So you made this vector. The symbol C stands for concatenate. So you want to put this ways, you concatenate the three values, 1, minus 1, and 3, and you have prepared this vector. And if you write down the following line, what is, we use the square brackets for the components of the vector. So x bracket 3 is the third component, and this is simply x of 3. You see the result of this on the left bottom part. So you see that x of 3 is equal to 3. You see it out there. Is it clear? Any problems? No, just want to be sure that... Is that okay?
Yeah, I need to understand. You went to the third component. Where is the second component?
The second component is minus one. So I'm just saying
this
that...
The first component?
The first component is 1, the second component is minus 1, the third component is 3. I'm just saying it this way. I'm defining the whole vector in this way.
So, because I got lost as you started. This one is the input.
The input, well, this is just an example, it's not particularly.
Yeah.
Just to say, okay, I want to make a vector that has first component 1, second component minus 1, and third component 3. And how I write it, I say concatenate the three numbers and assign them to the variable x that then becomes a vector with
so
these three components.
So now if we put another comma here and we can create a fourth component?
Yes.
Simple, thank you.
Just to be sure, since there was some doubt, R is an interactive language. So you have this script, and generally you execute the lines each at a time. So now we changed our mind about what was x. So we add a fourth component, we add a comma, and we have a fourth component equal to minus 3. We execute this, and now we have changed x. Now x is a different vector, but still x of 3 will be 3. And just for curiosity, if we have x of 4 will be this number that we had put it before, x of 4 will be minus 3. And if you try x of 5, I'm not sure exactly what it will say, but something that does not exist. X of 5, when it says NA, stands for not available. What R uses for, say, missing values. So this is x of 5 has not been defined, so it's a missing value in some sense. There are some other tricks. So for instance, if you put a minus in front, x of minus 2 is not the minus 2 component. It's saying it's a vector without the second component. So we take the same vector and we scrape out the second component. So if we write that, x of minus 2 has become 1, 3, minus 3. So we erased the minus 1 that was the second component has become a shorter vector without that component. Okay? Just some basic way of handling vectors. Beyond vectors, there are matrices that have two indices. There are other kind of constructs that you can make. But when we are, I think I will keep to the simplest ways. Any problem? There are simplest way of creating vectors. Instead of saying which all the components are, instead of saying concatenate this and this, there are also other ones, but I think I will use only this one, in which I put 1:10, and this means all the integer numbers between 1 and 10. There are more general ways of doing that, but I don't want to put too many things in this introduction. So we decide we use this method to create a vector. So if we create this vector, as I said, this assignment is the same as equal. Perhaps it's not completely true for computer scientists, but effectively, they are more or less the same thing as far as I understand. So one can use. And this creates a vector has values from 1 to 10. And so we say run, and we create it. Sometimes we forget to say run, and then things don't exist, and we have to go back. One can do operations on a whole vector. So for instance, if I have this vector x and I multiply it by 4, I hope you guess what happens. So you multiply each component of the vector by the number 4. So x times 4, the result is that you get 4, 8, 12, 16, up to 40. Okay? So you can, operations are performed on, you can make operations on a whole vector. Just to show you something else, so we can do something more, I'm using this command, rnorm, where r stands for random number, norm stands for normal variable, so rnorm creates random numbers from the normal distribution. And in this way, when I say 10, I say create a vector made with 10 random numbers from the normal distribution. If you don't know what rnorm means or you forget, what you can do, and this is always advisable, you can type perhaps down here so it doesn't get into the script. Down in the lower part, you can always type commands that don't get in the script. So we can say, help rnorm. I don't remember, I know there is a command with that name, but I don't remember exactly what it does. So I write help rnorm, and this opens something on the right part that not necessarily will be easy to read, because not always the help is very, it's informative, but not always very easy to read. But if you go through that, it says, okay, these are the normal distribution, and there are these four possibilities. You can have D norm, P norm, Q norm, R norm, as for any other, for many other probability distribution. And what are the values? And this is a sort of an explanation. D norm gives the density, P norm gives the distribution, Q norm gives the quantile, and R norm, the one that we are using now, generates random numbers from that distribution. And then there are other things, and hopefully there are some examples. Yeah, there are, the examples are often rather complicated, but basically we can look back at the usage. This is quite simple. The usage is simply R norm of n, how many random numbers we want, and then says mean and standard deviation. So just to give you some other examples, this is R norm. And this will have created some numbers that I will show you in a second. However, we can also decide we don't want standard deviation equal 1. And so we can add some lines. So we can say Z2 R norm 10. And then we can say mean equal 0, standard deviation equal 0.5. Or we can also say without without using the names, we can simply say that. Or we can say just say what we want to change, so the standard deviations. So these are three equivalent ways of generating random numbers that have a standard deviation equal 0.5 instead of 0. R uses the names, so we can use the names to give the parameters of the functions. Also, all functions are written in a way that they have some standard values for parameters. If we don't give the values, they use a standard one. So in this case, mean is equal to zero. And so we need to give only the ones that we want to correct. So we can say either 0 and 0.5, because in order they would go mean and standard deviation, or just to say standard deviation equal whatever. And the mean is what is the standard values, that is 0. So it's a very flexible language, which is helpful, although it can be a bit confusing sometimes, especially when you see expert programs, it will be a little confusing understanding exactly what they're doing. But the idea, this is a way of generating numbers. A very important command is plot. Plot can be very complex, but the simplest way to use it is just to give it, well, perhaps it's not the simplest, but if you want to do a scatter plot, you give it two vectors. One will be the variable on the x-axis and the other one on the y-axis. So we have x are the values from 1 to 10, z are some random numbers, and so if we plot xz, we expect to see some random numbers around that. So if we run this command plot xz, it opens still on this part here, and we get a graph something like that. It may not be beautiful. You can change, if you wish, you can change what is the point, whether you want a line or a point. You can change the scale. You can do a lot of things. But without doing anything, we get something like that, that are the points on this axis. I don't know why it's not showing the x-axis. It's really ugly. This is particularly ugly. The ones I get generally a bit better. OK. Any problems so far? Any problem? OK. No? Now we do we create another vector through this command, y equal 2 times x plus z. Of course, you can also sum vectors, and you can also multiply vectors in a way that is not mathematical. But in general, you can, well, I'll just show you. You can also do x times z. It's perfectly legal. This means we multiply two vectors, component by component. It's not a mathematical standard operation among vectors, but is what it does. And actually, in this case, they are of the same length, and so it's easier. R is also able to multiply vectors of different length, although it will complain. Why does it print the result? Because I did not put the result in a variable. So by default, if I put the result in a variable, the result is not written. If I like that, if I just say x times z, this is a sort of a calculator. And so it does not put the result in a variable, but simply shows the result. So x times z is multiplying each component of x times each component of z. So this is, I'm doing something else. So I'm multiplying x by 2 and I'm adding a random variable. And then I plot these values. And this I just say, OK, I add to this plot what are the limits in x, y from 0 to 8 doesn't make a lot of sense. I think I had done it with different numbers. So let's say from 0 to 12, so we have some space, and from 22. So we plot x, we have the, now we plot x and y, and we tell the limit on the x-axis are 0 and 12, the limits on the y-axis are 0 and 22. I'm not sure they are good limits, I just to show you what we get. Okay, we get something like that that is not particularly intriguing, but we have the points, plotted points. Okay, you may have noticed that this looks like a regression model. Y, we're getting y as something times x plus an error. So we can try to make the regression of y on x. So we look at the only statistical program, of, I think, in this class. So what we do is this. LM stands for linear model. And so we're computing a linear model that has y as independent variable and x, no, the opposite, y as dependent variable and x as predictor variable. And we use this sign here to say what, which variables the dependent variable depends on. So it's a symbolic way of writing a regression. So we have a regression of the vector y on the vector x. And we write it like that. This, so this is a linear regression of x on y on x. In the same way, you can do multiple regression analysis of variance and a lot of other things that all fit into the scheme of linear models. If you have seen some statistics, you will know what I'm saying. So this has created reg that is the output of the regression. That is a complicated variable. To know what is in reg, we can say summary is something you can do in a lot of complex structures. So reg is a complex structure. We could look at the help with sort of structure it is, but it's not particularly important from the practical point of view. So one way we can learn something about reg is to ask, let's ask for the summary of what we had. And so we have an output like that, that if we know some statistics, hopefully you know what they are saying. So it says a lot of things. So first of all, it says, what was the formula that we used? What was the regression formula? The regression formula was y on x. So this is a summary of what we had done. Then it computes the residuals. So you know the residuals are the distance of the points from the regression lines. And the residuals have a minimum, a first quartile, a median, a third quartile, and a maximum. Then we can also look at the residuals if we want. Then it tells us which are the coefficients of the regression. So it's telling that the intercept is 1, basically. And the estimate of the slope is 1.8, more or less. You know that we have generated the points that should have had a slope 2, but OK, from the data points, the estimate of the slope is 1.8. Possibly you have different numbers, because we use random numbers. We did not fix the seed, so every all you have will have different numbers out here. If you want to have the same numbers, you have to put a seed before building the random numbers. But we did not do so. Everybody will have different numbers. Then we have the standard error of this estimate. And then there is a test on the on this coefficient. So basically, the last column says it computes is a p-value for the test of whether the coefficient can be 0. And so, for instance, it's saying here that the slope cannot be 0. We are quite sure that the real slope of the regression is not 0, while the intercept could well be. And then it tells you something about residual R-square, residual standard error, etc. It's not so important, just to say something. We can ask one another way to say, to know how to access everything else has done is to know that this structure reg, I called it reg, it's just the output, has a lot of names that one can use. So one can use reg dollar coefficient, reg dollar residuals, reg dollar effects, and we'll have some information about the results of the regression. So for instance, reg dollar coef are the two coefficients that we have seen. So we'll reg dollar coef is a vector that has two components, and the components have also a name. So the first component has also the name intercept. The second component has also the name x to remember that was the slope on the variable x. But we can access this simply, I always do that, simply through the component. So reg dollar coef of 2 is the second component of this vector, so will be the number 1.755 or whatever you have. Okay? Any problems so far? Because I'm more or less at the end of my introduction to R. There are some bizarre thing in R that I don't understand. Somehow, summary of reg has more information than the reg itself. So for instance, I'm not able to find these two standard errors that we had seen before, this value 0.5524. I'm not able to find it from reg dollar coef or anything. But instead, if you say summary of reg dollar coef, so you ask the coefficient not of reg, but of the summary of reg, this is a matrix. It's not only the first, while reg dollar coef was only these two numbers, summary reg dollar coef is all this matrix. And so, for instance, if we want to know what is the standard error of the slope, we can find what is the standard error of the slope by saying summary of reg. I'm not sure that these brackets are useful. $2.2. This is the standard value of standard error. So if we need it for some reason, we can find it over there. If we need it for making further computations. OK? Any doubt? Sure.
When you want to know the standard error for the coefficient,
yes.
I was expecting to see the whole column of the standard error for the first parameter and the standard error for the second parameter, but there I only have one standard error.
And because I asked, okay, the question was why did I get only one value for the standard error? I got only one value because I asked for that. So I said, the second row and the second column. If I want, this actually reminded me of a trick. If you want to see the whole column, there is a trick to see the whole a whole column of a matrix. And the trick is the following. If I just say coef square brackets comma 2, this shows me the whole second column. So if I don't say which row I want to see, it shows me all the rows. So in this case, the second column. So now I see both of them, the standard error of the intercept and the standard error of the slope. And guess how I, if I want to see instead a whole row of the matrix, how I would do? Just I do the reverse and I see a whole row, but just simply by saying, okay, I want to see everything about the slope, then I get, I'd say 2, comma, and I, then I close without saying which column I want, and I see all the second row. Well, you have you might have noticed another thing of R. If you want to put comments, you start with this, with the hash. You might have guessed it by now that this was a comment character. Okay, this is more or less everything about my introduction to R. I will use it in a second to discuss a bit of how to use it for estimate parameters of epidemic models. We'll have only to learn a new thing, how to read a file. And unfortunately, this is always a very annoying thing. Reading data, there are often problems, and this is something you should check. But first, I give a very quick introduction to... I go to the second slide here. So first of all, a recognition that most of what I will show you in terms of R script is based on material developed by other people. So if you look on the web, you find quite a few files developed by Aaron King, especially, and Pejroani and John Drake, with the help of other people. So most of what I will do is based on their work. And so it's nice to recognize that. And what we will do is basically, hopefully, this thing. So estimate R0 from initial epidemic growth. So suppose you have observed the beginning of an epidemic, how you estimate R0, the basic reproductive number that we thought was so important. You can also want to estimate R0 from the final size of an epidemic, although this is more helpful in hindsight than before. You might want to estimate all the parameters or some parameters of the model by fitting the trajectory by least square. We will also discuss how to do it instead in a more probabilistic statistical way by using maximum likelihood method. And this is based on the idea that we have only observational error. What does it mean? That the true model is deterministic, but there is some observation error. So this is would be the model generated the data. And I think it's nice if I can arrive at this point. Something that one could build on that, using maximum likelihood, one could build confidence intervals for the parameters. One could include detail on observation error. And let's see if I am able to do that. Another thing that would be nice to do is to use proper statistical methods by including what is called like dynamical noise, so a true stochastic model, so assuming that noise is also intrinsically generated by the model. And one could also use a Bayesian method. All these things that are in italic I'm not planning to do, but I would be happy to discuss. The idea of this lecture is to give some methods so that in the final project, when we will ask people to do some work, they are able to do something on programming on R. So it's a sort of quick way. It's very little for experts. It's not meant to be. Very quick thing on the first topic. How do we estimate R0 from initial epidemic growth? Well, from what has been shown at the beginning of an epidemics, you can assume that the initial value of the infectives will be small, susceptibles will be a lot and will be change more slowly. So initially, in most epidemic models, you can prove the infectives will grow exponentially with some rate. This is the beginning of the epidemic. For T small, you have something like that. If in particular, in the case of a simple SIR model, and assuming that almost everybody is susceptible, so you have to otherwise have to change something, then R can be written as beta minus gamma. This is a very simple observation. So eventually, you can write it as R0 minus 1 divided the average infectious period. So there is this simple formula. And what is the idea? That often you can estimate little r from data. Once you have estimated little r from data, you can use this formula in the reverse and say, OK, R0 is 1 plus r times ti. Of course, this assumes that I have estimated r and that I know somehow the average infectious period. So this is how this formula is based. Some comments. Well, of course, if there are some uncertainty on R, for instance, from the estimation procedure and on the infectious period, this will translate into uncertainties in R naught. The relation is somewhat more complicated if I don't have an SIR model. In principle, there is a general formula. So if I know the relative infectivity, I can express R0 through this ratio of the Laplace transform of the infectivity kernel. In first approximation, if R is small, this formula is anyway true. So if R is close to 0, this formula is true whatever is the model that generated it. If R is not particularly small, then you would need some correction. So for instance, in case you have a latent period, you should compute R0 through the formula like that. One nice thing of this way of estimating that underreporting is not important. Because if you remember, we estimate R from the initial epidemic growth. And even if only 10% of the cases are reported, this, as long as it's 10% that doesn't depend on time, this will not affect the estimate of little r and so on. So this is a quite robust thing. Of course, we assume that there is not a change in underreporting, so perhaps there is more attention at the beginning or less after or something like that. And one can apply this formula either how I wrote it, it has to be with the number of infected people. But often, one doesn't have the number of infected people at a given time, but knows how many new cases have occurred in any time interval. You have a certain reporting, and you're told there have been 24 cases this week. And so you can use the same method to that. Something very popular is to use this method not to cumulative cases, so all cases from the beginning of the epidemic. This makes a very nicer curve because this looks much more exponential, but often may cause some statistical, perhaps it's not perfect from the statistical point of view. And one important thing that, okay, here everything is done as if parameters were constant. We know that parameters are not constant. For instance, there may be something that is done in the beginning of an epidemic to prevent it further expansion. So one can use some instance in time and make some sort of local estimates. So an estimate that is valid over a certain time window, and then perhaps things have changed. At least empirically, one could do that.
What does TI stand for?
TI stands for the average infectious period. I thought I had written here. Okay. TI is the average infectious period that in the case of a simple SIR model is 1 over gamma. If it's a more complicated model, it will be something else. Okay, final thing. I have put, you will have on the desktop a few data files that are either CSV file or a text file. And these have some source, come from some source. I will use in this lecture only the first two, but you may want to look at the other ones and try to play it a bit around. And these are more or less the same files in two different formats, and this might have. I will use this one, but the other one may be easier to read. Finally, we're not discussing what exactly these data are, but of course, if you want to do sound scientific work, you should know as much as possible about how the data were collected. So this is something I'm not discussing, but it's really important to do something. Okay. So now we go back here, and we have to do to read the file. So we do what. Okay, you should write it. You can write it also on more lines. So I split it on two lines so it's easier to read and so we can see how it looks like. So what the important command is read.csv that says read a CSV file, a comma separated file, and put it in this variable that is called boarding. This variable will be something that is called a data frame. I will discuss when this operation is done, we'll discuss a bit how it is done. And what are the arguments of read.csv? Well, the first one is the name of the file in quotes. And this we should check that you're working in the same directory. So if it says file does not exist, we will see how to make sure that you work in the same directory as the file is otherwise. Then I added a few things because I know how the file looks like. So I know how it has been created. So this file has some description of the data. And I say, OK, lines that start with the hash are just comments. Don't try to interpret the lines that start with the hash as data. And the other thing is something to do with the fact that one of the columns contains dates. And dates are one of the things that are always a nightmare to read because they have to be interpreted. And this should work and should be able to read what is written on the file at this. And the simplest, if you split the command into lines to make it more readable, you execute very simply. You say run on the first line. It moves on the second line. And down here, you see it has not completed the command. It has a plus. Expect something else to come. And then up here, you say run. And of course, I'm not in the correct directory. So if you're not in the correct directory, doesn't find the file, it says, cannot open file, no such file or directory. So now I will try to fix to have it working. I have to find out where I have the file. Is in data desktop. And then from here. There is a simpler way, if I remember. Of course, there is a command, but set in session there is a set working directory, and we say choose directory. And we choose desktop. Data, at least for me. Okay. Now has set the directory in which I have the file, and now hopefully it should work. Okay, now has worked. So if the command does not work, you're in the wrong directory and you can do other things, but you should tell the program to run in the directory where the data file is. Okay, the data file, you go to session.
Session.
Set working directory, choose directory.
Okay.
And you hopefully know where I think it's desktop, uh-huh. Data, uh-huh. Open.
Open.
Okay.
Yeah, I can through.
Okay, and now you should be able to uh-huh. run this one.
Uh-huh.
Run, yeah. Run. Okay, now it works. Okay. The error is simply that it couldn't find the file.
So the file was not.
The file boarding school influenza was not in the directory in which it was looking for, and now you say look into this directory and now I should find it. How do I do it?
Yeah, it's given this. So
okay, you have data. And you say open.
Okay,
it did not work. Let me see why. Session. Set working directory. Okay, now it should work. And
I use this untitled.
Oh, you're using untitled. Okay, now it works. Is it working for everybody? Any problems? Okay, now that the program, the file has been read, you have this variable that is called boarding, and boarding is what is called a data frame. A data frame is essentially a matrix that has columns that can have different types. So you can see by head, I ask, show me the first few lines of this data frame so that I don't So I can get some ideas. And so you can see it has three columns. The first column is called date. The second is called cases. The third is called status. The first column has values are dates. I hope that you recognize this as being dates in 78. Cases are numbers, so numbers of infected people that day. And status is a character variable that we can understand what it means. So it is a data frame, is a matrix that has columns that have different names. This is basically what it is. And now we plot this data. If you go towards the end, you can see that the status can be either confined or convalescent. And I know nothing about this data. They come from some strange. But I decided that the confined ones are the real infected. The convalescent are somehow removed, and so we're not considering them as infected. And so what I want to do is to plot this data, using, however, only the ones that are have status confined. And I show you what is the command if you see it completely. So what we do is this. Plot cases versus date. So this is just the opposite syntax of what we used before. It's the one that we use for linear model. So cases will go on the y-axis and date on the x-axis. However, this value, cases and date, exists only within this structure that is called boarding. So I have to say, if I just stopped here, you can try for your curiosity. If you say plot cases versus date, it says I don't exist. So you want to say plot cases versus date, taking the data from the structure that we call boarding. Type equal B says use both lines and points. So this, use this only for lines and points. Use only the subset of the ones that are confined, not the ones that are have status convalescent. And then I'm not sure I use both of them. This is use a logarithmic scale to show the data. So if we run this, and since we split it into lines, we have to do it a couple of things, we get this not particularly interesting picture that shows the data from January 22. So these are more or less a little more than 10 days. And these are in logarithmic scale. As you can see, it goes 1 to 10, 10 to 200. Why do we like the logarithmic scale? Because it gives some idea that initially the data are really in exponential phase, because in logarithmic scale, these at least the first points look more or less linear. Not perfect, but it's not too bad. Okay, any problems? Maybe I show you again the. Type B means show use both points and lines, so we see we have a better idea. You're not able to read the file?
Yeah.
Okay, it's probably in another directory. So did you put it in on your laptop? Okay, so this is in home data, okay, but now let's, okay, let's, then let's go back to our studio. And, session, set working direct.
I have to set working direct to be that.
Yes, the one in which there are the data. Okay, now it should work. Let's try again.
Yeah. Oh. Then it's working.
Nothing. It works? Okay, any problems? Great. Now we decide, okay, if we want to find what is the coefficient, this little r, we say we look at the first points and we try to estimate r from the data. So we want to find what is the linear growth here in logarithmic scale. And just by say, okay, we say, well, probably the first 5 points are okay. There is a certain arbitrariness in deciding what is initial phase, and you welcome to the to discuss this perhaps by experiments. But I say, okay, let's try the first 5 points. So we choose the first 5 points to fit a line through these and decide this is little r. And so how we do that? Okay, we could do in different ways. Perhaps this is a bit more involved, but I think is useful. So we do linear model, the one that we learned that is we need to do linear regression. Log of cases, so the independent variable is the logarithm of the cases. The dependent variable. The independent variable is the date, so we want to do logarithm of the cases on the date. Which are the data? The data will be not the whole boarding, but the subset of the boarding data frame in which the status is confined, and the date is less than 27 January, because if you remember, this is 22, 23, 24. We want to arrive only to 26. So the date is less than 27. And I'm sure there is a better way of writing that, but this is a more involved way of saying which is the 27 of January. I wrote it this way. There may be people that are good in R can write it this in a better way. But the, all these complicated ways to say date is less than 27 January, 78. So these will be the first 5 points. This works. I'm sure there are better ways, simpler ways of saying that. Because I say, I write 27 January 78, and I tell it the first two are the day, the second two are the month, the third two are the year. And so this works. And otherwise, I'm always unsure of what it does. OK, so we run this program here, and then we can ask a summary of the results. A summary of the results is as following. Well, it tells you what is the formula. It tells us what are the residuals. This time, there are only 5 points, so the residuals is not telling us which is the minimum, which is the maximum. It tells us all 5 residuals that we get. Residuals are the difference between the observed value and what is predicted by the regression. It tells you what are the coefficients. And basically, we don't do anything with the intercept. We don't interpret the intercept. We interpret only the slope. And the slope is telling that little r is 1.33 measured in day to the minus 1. So we found that the estimate of little r is 1.33. And then we have a certain standard error, and we can do things. And I put this value here. I call it r estimate. So I put in r estimate this value, 1.33, that we found from this. And this is with, I erase that, this is not, we have already seen it. And then I want to have also some confidence interval for r. I also ask to r to tell me what is the standard error of r. So the standard error is what I called rr. And then, well, you know that in principle, this variable should follow a t distribution with a certain number of degrees of freedom. And so this should help in computing the confidence interval. Coming. A question or a problem?
Problem.
On this regression 5, why do we have, when you're finding the regression coefficients, why do we have a log here?
Why? Because we want to do this in, we expect that, maybe I write, can I write it here?
Yes, you can write.
So we expect that the data here t is more or less I0 e to the rt. Yeah. And then I couldn't do a regression on that. Yeah. So instead, the log of it is more or less the log of I0 plus rt. And so we want to do the regression of the log on time to estimate little r. Question? No. Yes.
But this result, and when I do summary, I didn't get.
Okay, didn't finish the comment. I'll check. Okay.
Summary is not working.
Okay, I'll check why the, what's missing here. Okay, here we just finished somehow because there is a. Oops, I don't know what I did here. I thought I was here. I just want to finish here because there is. Okay, there is an error. Fine. Now we want.
Up, I think.
I want to open, yes, it's a little bit up.
Yes.
Log case. Okay. You haven't done the. You have. When things are split in lines, you have to run all the lines one after the other because it's still waiting for the comma, now has completed the thing.
Okay, so it is not good to select all and run, no?
Better to do it one line at a time. It's also more safe in the case because if you select it and you press something, you can erase it by mistake. So it's.
The summary is not working. I don't know where it's the
problem. Okay, because this hasn't worked.
Yeah.
So let's try again. Had worked and now summary works.
Okay, yeah.
You have to run things one at a time.
I have a question.
Sure.
In the summary statistic there.
Yes.
Like the R squared.
Yes.
From an econometric point of view, we explain it like there is 98.6%.
Yes.
We show that 98.6% of the changes that is occurring with any dependent variable is being explained by the independent variable. But now
yes,
epidemiology.
This is now. Well, he was asking the question is okay. What does this R square equals 0.986 means? And somehow, I mean, if the data were exactly from the deterministic model, we would expect to have R square equal 1. Of course, this we don't expect this to happen. We always expect, well, first of all, the data will not perfectly be exponential. Then there will be some mistake in the data reporting or something. So we expect, we're happy if R square is large enough to say, okay, they are very close to being exponential. Just as something, if we have R square beyond 95%, I would be extremely happy. So this, so I would say 98.6% is very good. I think this is very close to being exponential, and I'm happy with that.
So what's different with the adjusted one?
Okay, the adjusted is it's something, it's not related to this problem, but basically it's something in the regression problem when you want to choose which is the best model. If we just measure R square, the more predictor you add, the more R square will become great. And so it's not a good way of measuring fit. R square adjusted somehow, I don't remember how, takes into account the number of parameters you have been estimated. So it is it decreases R square by some quantity, it has to do with the number of parameters. So if you want to judge two different models with different number of parameters, you may decide that R square adjusted is a reasonable measure to decide which one is better. But this is quite away from what we are doing now.
So the bigger it is, the better?
The bigger R square adjusted, the better, yes. That's the idea. Any questions? Okay, the confidence interval, it's not really important, but we know from the theory that if all assumptions or linear regressions are satisfied, the estimator follows a T distribution with a certain number of degrees of freedom. And once you know that, and once you know the standard error, that is what is the standard error, so what is the standard deviation of the coefficient, then you can find a 95% confidence interval by multiplying the standard error times some quantile of the T distribution. If we had a lot of data, we could use here 1.96, the famous number from the normal distribution. But since we have our degrees of freedom are 3, I thought worth better to use, more fair to use that. It would take some time to discuss in statistics, but if you have seen a standard error of regression coefficient, this is how you get a confidence interval for regression coefficient. So basically, the result of this is that the estimate for little r is 1.33, and we expect that we should add plus or minus 0.29 to be fair. So we could say little r is between 1.03 and 1.63, more or less. This is what we can statistically say from this data. We can translate this into a value for R0 if we know what is the average period of infectivity. There is a general idea, this was flu, that for flu, a reasonable period of infectivity is 2.5 days. And if we believe that this is 2.5 days, we can get estimates. Okay. We can get an estimate that is 4.32 with a confidence interval that goes more or less from 2.6 to 5.05. So it's quite wide because we don't have a lot of data points, but gives you the uncertainty that we have from on the value. Okay, so this is an example of how you can use incidence data to have an estimate of R0. Okay. this print is not very nice. It's something that R does not do very particularly well is the printing of the results. So if you want to have a nicely looking result, you'd better do something else. But this is just to have some output of the results that we obtained.
Why is it that only print the last row? Why not running from the top to the bottom?
Why?
Or is it possible to run from the top to the bottom? Because when I run, it just gives me the last value. It does not give me the previous value.
I'm not sure the problem.
Do I have to save every time I put a line? Or
no.
Why is it giving me just the last value?
Well, here it gives you the last value that you computed and then the previous one. What I don't see the problem.
Okay, see for example, if I put
okay, yeah, there is something that, okay.
So
because
you
run this
line.
Okay, you'd better think as soon as you write a line.
You have to save it.
You run it,
okay. Is it possible to make it run everything without doing every time? Because
well, you can write the program. I mean, if you write it the whole thing, now you, for instance, you start here.
Yeah.
And you say run.
Yeah.
Okay. It just there is a.
Also, I have to go select.
You don't have to select. You just go here, and you say run, and then run, and then run, and then run. Of course, if you.
Oh, it's run where is it?
Yeah, run mass. Goes one further with the man. Yeah. The printer? Well, it's not particularly nice. I think something better can be done, but.
Suppose I want to change the case. Where did I go to here to find?
You want to change?
Line, yeah.
Which
if
one?
I want to change this case, this variable.
Here, okay. You want to change the case, this variable. We go in the plot.
In the plot?
And you write here, you don't like to see cases.
Mm-hmm.
You write ylab equals something. Equal, I don't know, a name that you like. H doesn't mean anything, but you can do. And then if you do run. No, it was somewhere. It was something inside here. We have to quit it here. I don't know.
I just took it, yeah? The old.
And then have H here. Is that, was that your question?
No, I want to change the values.
The scale.
Oh, the scale.
The scale,
okay.
The values, not the variable.
Well, especially in logarithmic scale, it's not easy. It decides by itself. If you want to take out the logarithmic scale, it's something.
I have one other question. You know, this is more of a calculation of small numbers. You work with small numbers. How do you handle with errors? You know, there are lots of errors.
Well, in fact, we compute the confidence interval.
Yeah, okay.
The confidence interval should give you some idea what is the
cumulative error.
Yeah, what is the. Yeah, the uncertainty that we have.
In this case, what means R0?
R0 means should be the expected number of individuals infected by a single infectious within its infectious period. So this is saying we expect. We think that R0 is 4, but could be somewhere between 2.6 and 5 point something.
get here.
Okay. That's something not fair, because it remembers, that's why one could do things better. Dated because it remembers that that variable was had a name date because it came from a regression on the variable date. And so it it goes on remembering that. That's why I'm saying that the output is not very nice. You should basically ignore that. You should ignore that the fact that it's said. That's why I prefer not to insist on how the printing looks like, because one should do things better. Is there a question?
Yeah.
And then I...
Yeah, my question is like statistics, because I can see the way you've calculated the R0.
Yes.
So by taking one pass.
Yeah.
So, and if I compare this, the way you calculate this and the way it is calculated here, where is the PDF document? Yeah, so it is here.
Yes.
This one. So what is this small R?
Small R is what you estimated from the data.
The
exponential, this this parameter here.
Ah, okay.
Okay, very quickly, well, at least one thing is simple to do, although not particularly interesting, is to say, okay, perhaps you know that in Kermack-McKendrick model, there is a formula for the final size. So if you know R0, you know how many people will be infected at the end in Kermack-McKendrick model. And the relation can be written like that. If Z of infinity is the total number of people that have been infected, there is this relation that you can find, that 1 minus z of infinity divided by n is equal to e to the minus r0 times z of infinity divided by n. So in principle, if you know r0, and if Kermack-McKendrick model is true, which generally is not, but if it were true, if you know R0 from the beginning of the epidemic, you say R0 is equal 1.8, you can tell, okay, 75% of the population will be infected at the end. However, you can use the formula also in the reverse. So if you know how many people have been infected at the end of epidemic, then you can tell what was R0 of the epidemic. And simply reversing that formula here says R0 equals the log of 1 minus z of infinity divided by n divided minus z of infinity divided by n. And since in this case there was this epidemic in a boarding school, we know n and we know z of infinity, so people tell how many people were in the boarding school and how many have been infected, we should be able to tell what was R0 in this epidemic. So we have that Z of infinity was 512, N was 764, and then we can compute the formula. So this is a complete different way of estimating R0 once we know the final size. Of course, it's not very interesting from the predictive point of view, because we can tell it only after the epidemic has finished, but it might be still interesting. So we compute Zn, R02 equal this, and then writing like that, we ask what is R02. And R0 that we find from this estimation is very different from R0 that we found from the other estimation. So we find R0 equal 1.655. Okay. It's much smaller. So do you have any suggestions? Okay. The first estimate was based on the first 5 points of the curve. This estimate is based only on the total number of infected people. So it uses a different information. Here we, in the first one, we use the first 5 points. In the other one, we use only the total number. I don't know. There are many possible explanations. One is that Kermack-McKendrick model is wrong, and possibly there was a heterogeneity in the population. Perhaps some were more immune to the to flu, and so in the beginning, only the first one that were more susceptible got infected. And eventually, the one that were more immune didn't get. So this is, or possibly, even if it was a boarding school, mixing was not homogeneous. There was more mixing within classes or whatever it was organized. And so eventually, some classes escaped being infected at all. So you can make a lot of explanations. Another possible explanation is that the estimate that we did on the infectious period was wrong. Because that estimate is true, that is may be correct, that is a mean infectious period of flu from the biological point of view. But if people were sick were confined in bed, perhaps they stopped being infecting other people by that. And so what I asked just by curiosity is, what would be the length of infectious period that would make the two estimates consistent. It's not necessarily true, but if what would be the estimate of the infectious period that would make the first estimate of little r compatible with this estimate of R0, and this would be the computation. So we would get that gamma should be 2.52, and so the two estimates would be compatible if the effective infectious period would be half of a day, which perhaps is not particularly reasonable, but this is. Does it work? Because I think you didn't do things in order. You have to be precise to run all the instructions one after the other.
What is the, how do you explain this exponential growth rate? What is the explanation
here? I mean, the fact that exponential growth rate is something, I mean, once if you start from small numbers, initially, the model will be essentially linear. And solution of linear models are exponential. I don't know if that's... as long as you haven't infected many people, every new encounter will be susceptible. And so things grow linearly in the beginning, more or less. You have a question down here? It's not showing because we haven't written here. Because I you can write here as well. So I had written over here.
Okay, you wrote this one your own.
So I just write here T true. And this date is just a confusing thing, but.
Can I have this in my laptop?
You can have this in your laptop. Hmm? Yeah, sure. You can just copy this file to your laptop.
Okay.
You can save this and transfer to your laptop with a flash or whatever. Okay, as you see, there was a lot more that I was hoping to do. And I just tell you what's, I think you have this R script, so you can try it by yourself when you have some time in the afternoon and maybe asking me. What I'm doing here is, first of all, I show you how to solve a system of differential equations using R. So the first part is to, I just go quickly and then you try it when you have time and then you ask me, I'm here. So this is the package that you need. So you have to use this package that is not part of the standard thing of R. Then you have a function. You have to define what is the function that tells what is the SIR model. So for instance, you write that this is quite simple. You're basically writing the equation as you know. So ds dt equal minus beta si divided total population size, etc. So this is the function that defines what is the system that we want to solve. So and if you don't want to do the SIR model, you write whatever you like. So this is the system. Then you define what are the parameters, because I prefer to write it in a way that is very free, so you can change parameters freely. And then what you do is you call the function ODE, ordinary differential equation, that is part of this package dsolve, telling what is the function that you want to integrate, what is the initial value, in which times you want to compute it, and which are the parameters of the model, because this is written in terms of parameters. So out will the variable out will include all the values, the solution at the times that you that we have decided. In this case, the times have been decided for 50 weeks with some numbers. And then I plot the result. So first of all, the first thing that we do, I show you how to use R to solve system of differential equations. So we have a couple of examples of solutions of differential equations. Then what I do afterwards is to try to estimate. And to estimate means that we have some data, and we compute a function that is called SSE.SIR that computes the square difference between the data and the model prediction. So the second ingredient is computing the square difference between data and model prediction. And the third point is to use the function optim that does multidimensional optimization. So optim is what we use to minimize the square deviation. We tell to use optim to minimizing this function that we called SSE.SIR. So basically, there are three ingredients. One is the routine optim, that is something that is part of R, that is a function that finds the minimum of a multidimensional function, and seems to work quite well in my experience. Then you have a function, this function SSE.SIR, that computes the square deviation between data and model prediction. And then, of course, you need a function that computes the model prediction. So it's a bit involved, but I think I tried to split into steps that you can more or less follow. I hope to do it right now, but there was no time, so we have the coffee break. But I'm happy to. Maybe you can try on your laptop or here in the afternoon, and we can talk. It's 11? I thought it was at 10:30.
The next lecture is at 11:30.
It's at 10:30, the coffee break.
No, it's at 11.
The next lecture is?
Because there was a free.
Oh, okay.
So you can have longer.
Okay, apparently coffee break is at 11. So if you want, we can go on for half an hour. Okay. Okay, then we go back here. Okay, the first point is to use this package. So require dsolve says that if you haven't yet installed, it says it doesn't exist. If you haven't, otherwise it will be it will load the package if not yet or just not do anything. So this is very simple. Then we define the function, and the function will have to be a function of t that is. This will be the right-hand side of a system of differential equations. So it will be a function of time, although the function that we will use will not depend on time explicitly, but in time should be an argument, of x, the independent variable of the system, and of some other parameters. So this should be the structure of the function that we use with dsolve. And I called it closed.sir.model. Function you have never seen before, but is a, well, if you have done some programming, you know what functions are. And function starts, you write function name, function of what, and then you have the curly brackets, and within curly brackets you write whatever the function does. And this is not important because the variables in principle is called x, but just for our sake we translate x of 1 into s, x of 2 into I, x of 3 into r. It's not important, but we do it because of that. Then we expect that in params there will be variables with name. One of the components of params will be called beta, one component will be called gamma, and one component will be called pop size. So this is a function based on the fact that we expect that the variable params will contain these names. Of course, if the variable params does not contain this name, then everything will the thing will not run. It's written in a way to be particularly friendly in the sense that you understand what the parameters mean and what everything means. And then the equation is very simple. The equation is, this is just a name. dsdt is just a name that we make it for ourselves to remember what it is. So dsdt is minus beta s I divided total population size. So this is a standard form that ABBA discussed yesterday. Di dt equal beta s I divided total population size minus gamma I. Dr dt equal gamma I. Note that you know that the variable r is useless. So we could, the program would run completely well enough if we scrap r from the system. But we keep it just in case it's needed. But of course, it's somehow it's, it doesn't matter. Finally, we put together the three variables that represent the time derivative into a unique vector that we call it dx dt, that is a vector where we concatenate the three components that we just computed before. Finally, this function, because of ODE, requires that the function, what is the output of the function? The output of the function has to be a list, because this is what ODE wants. And so we translate this dx dt that was a vector into a list. Don't ask me what is a list from the computer science point of view. I don't know. But list something, it makes it a list. And what the function returns is the last, so the list dx dt is what the function returns. So what is in the variable that is given in the last line of the function is what the function returns. So the value of the function will be this list that computes the three times derivatives. So this is the function. Then we try some example. And this example has R0 equal 4, but initial susceptible fraction, if you check, is just 2 over 5. So the effective R0 will be only 1.8.
So I didn't get that.
Okay. You know that if only a fraction of the population is susceptible, well, let's see from the practical point of view. R0 is the expected number of individuals an infectious individual will infect, assuming that everybody is susceptible. So R0 would be 4 if everybody was susceptible. However, we start with the initial population in which only 2/5 of the populations are susceptible. The other are immune, because I decide to put this initial value in the population. You see, I choose here S0 equal 20,000, but total population size is 50,000. Okay, so this means that if everybody were susceptible, I would infect 4 people. But of these 4 people, only 2/5 of those, 40% of those, are actually susceptible. So I will infect 4 times 40%. And 4 times 40% is 1.6. So the effective R0 will be 1.6. Is it clear? And you can see also from the point of view of the dynamical system, but I think this way is more clear. And so gamma equal 1.4 divided 14, that if we're thinking in terms of days means that the infectious period of whatever this infection is 14 days. And since R0 is beta over gamma, beta is equal to 4 times gamma. But the initial susceptible population size is 20,000 of a total population size that is 50,000. Are just numbers for us to see how the model works out. And then we say, OK, the starting point is in params. You see that params has a component called x0, a component called i0, a component called r0, and the components of the vector params have names. So I say take x start the component with names s0, y0, and r0. Then look at the solution every week for 50 weeks, because at times goes from 0 to 50 multiplied times 7. So it goes 0, 7, 14, etc. Since we're measuring times in days, this means I look at times every week. And then finally I have the solution. The solution is out, will be ODE with this function this initial starting point, computed this times value and this parameters thing. So finally, now we execute. Now that we've seen the line, I go run to every line of that. And now it should have worked. Now in the variable out, there should be the solution of the problem. If we want to know, we write out down here. And we see this is what the vector out contains. So the first component is time. The second component is a susceptible. It calls as 0 because this was initial value, but don't figure. And this is R0. So these are the values of that contained the variable. And so we can write plot as first variable, the first component, the first column of out, and on the y-axis, the third component of out, that is I. And I say to write type equal L, that means compute this, plot this with a line. And what I get is something like that. You have seen these things before, so this is a solution of Kermack-McKendrick model with some parameter values that we decided. OK, is it working?